This video is sponsored by NordPass. So there are huge updates on NASA's Artemis moon landing plans, with many more details about how the Artemis missions will be carried out and how and where the first NASA moon base should be built. But at the same time, Jim Bridenstine asks Senate appropriators for the necessary funding.
Will he get the funding? Because if not, this will delay NASA's return to the moon, and China isn't sleeping. The Chinese also updated their moon plans. But could they actually beat NASA to the moon in this new moon race? A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So NASA just released a huge update on the Artemis moon landing missions. More precise timelines, cost estimates, and updates on the future moon base plans, all released in a nice PDF, link of course in the description. So let's go through the most important points. Let's start with Artemis 1, the first mission of NASA's return to the moon. NASA is still very silent on the launch date of Artemis 1. We just know it will be late 2021. And unfortunately, we also do know that it will be based on SLS and Orion. It will be an unmanned flight of Orion around the moon, launched with SLS. It will be SLS's maiden flight, and even though you know that we are not fans of SLS, since we think it is insanely overpriced and not economical because it is not reusable, despite all this, of course, we'd still be happy to see the unmanned Orion moon round trip succeed. So NASA shared a few more details, namely that 13 CubeSats will also be launched with this mission, performing some scientific research while on the 1.4 million mile long journey.
And the systems for Artemis 1 are actually being tested right now. The SLS core stage had its fifth green run test, and the Orion capsule had its adapter installed to fit on SLS. The Northrop solid rocket boosters recently also had a firing test, so all systems are working. The Artemis 2 mission will of course be much more interesting, since it will be the first manned lunar round trip since the Apollo days. It will launch probably in 2022, also aboard SLS and Orion. During Artemis 2, life support systems will be tested, along with deep space network and relay satellite system communication, and of course also navigation systems. The Orion capsule will get as close as 4,600 miles or 7,400 kilometers to the far side of the moon and be slingshotted by the Earth and moon's combined gravity back to Earth. So they won't perform a lunar insertion burn. It will be a brief encounter with Luna. And since Orion will receive sunlight almost the entire time, the solar power generation will be tested as well. But of course, the Artemis 3 mission is where the real fun starts, since this is going to be the first manned lunar landing since Apollo 17 back in 1972. This return to the moon should already have happened decades ago. But well, we guess it's still better than not returning to the moon at all.
Anyways, the preliminary launch date for this is 2024, and Jim Bridenstine reiterated that the landing site will remain near Shackleton Crater at the lunar South Pole. It is not clear yet if this mission will make use of the Lunar Gateway, which will start construction already in 2023, the first two modules, the HALO and PPE modules, being delivered by a Falcon Heavy. What is clear though is that a human landing system will be needed. And the three landers under consideration are the national team's quite complicated moon lander, which we also like to call the Lobby Lander for obvious reasons, the more elegant Dynetics moon lander, and the totally OP and IMBA SpaceX Starship. So NASA now shared more details on the mission duration. Artemis 3 will stay 6 days on the moon, with at least 4 planned moonwalks or extravehicular activities, so-called EVAs, as they are called by NASA. 100 kilograms of science payloads will also be on board, and samples from the eternal shadows of the lunar South Pole craters will be collected and brought back to Earth for analysis, because we want to know how much water ice there is, of course. After Artemis 3, the Lunar Gateway will continue growing, involving international partners, and NASA will prepare for further Artemis missions, with the goal of establishing a first moon base, the so-called Artemis Base Camp. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because that would tremendously help us to continue talking about space politics, even of topics about which others shy away from, such as the US versus China space race, and even lobbyism and corruption in the space industry. And of course, you would also have our everlasting gratitude. Vielen Dank!
So the Artemis Base Camp will consist of three essential elements. First, the Lunar Terrain Vehicle, which is an unpressurized rover, similar to the famous Apollo moon rover. Then a habitable mobility platform, which is essentially a pressurized rover that will allow for a very high exploration range. And finally, the foundational surface habitat, which is a habitat module that will provide radiation shielding and allow for a crew of four astronauts to stay on the moon for up to 2 months. The Artemis Base Camp will grow and grow during the later Artemis missions, until by the late 2020s, maybe the first permanent lunar outpost can be established with multiple habitat modules, hopefully also involving international partners. During this time, the Lunar Gateway will also be expanded and resupplied by SpaceX's Dragon XL spacecraft. Japan is the first nation that announced to collaborate on the Gateway, and they even want to provide a pressurized lunar rover built by Toyota. So far for the Artemis plans. Everything, of course, reads really nicely on paper, but we know that it all depends on the necessary funding. And in order to ensure that funding, Jim Bridenstine urged Senate appropriators on Wednesday, September 23rd, to grant NASA the necessary funding for the fiscal year 2021, which starts on October 1st.
Specifically, in order to make it to the moon by 2024, NASA will need $3.2 billion in 2021 for the human landing systems, which is just a fancy term for the moon lander. Jim is optimistic and said after the hearing, quote, "I want to be clear that I really think that when the omnibus appropriations is complete, I really believe there will be $3.2 billion for a human landing system." Now, these $3.2 billion will be needed to progress further with two or more of the three companies which we mentioned before to build the Artemis moon lander. And Bridenstine wants to move forward with at least two, better yet, all three companies to the next phase, and it will be decided in March 2021 with which ones. So a lot depends on if NASA gets the necessary funding, and this can of course be delayed due to the pandemic, but even more so of course due to the upcoming elections.
And for the complete Artemis funding, NASA will need a total of $7 billion additionally in 2021. Because there is of course not only the human landing system, but also the SLS rocket, the Orion capsule, lunar suit, surface logistics, etc. Then additionally $6.64 billion in 2022, $6.58 billion in 2023, $5.43 billion in 2024, and $2.25 billion in 2025. So a total of $28 billion additionally by 2025. If NASA gets that funding, a 2024 manned moon landing with NASA can really happen. Jim Bridenstine thinks the chances are good for NASA to get that funding. However, if NASA doesn't get the necessary budget, the landing date will slip back, most likely to around 2028. And if that happens, the Chinese would be very, very happy.
Because only recently, the China Space Conference 2020 took place last week on Friday, the 18th of September, where the Vice Chief Engineer of the China Manned Space Engineering Directorate showed updates of their manned moon mission plans. It sometimes comes in quite handy that Jishuan can actually read all this, because for me this is like Egyptian hieroglyphs.
So first, the presentation shows a new rocket. It seems that the Chinese are giving up on the Long March 9. Instead, they seem to build a new human-rated rocket, very similar to Falcon Heavy, although it probably won't be reusable. The new rocket will have a LEO payload capacity of 70 metric tons and 25 metric tons to translunar injection. The other component of the Chinese manned moon program will be a capsule which we like to call the Red Dragon, as it looks heavily inspired by SpaceX's Crew Dragon and in fact has already been successfully tested on an unmanned test flight in May this year. The Red Dragon capsule will be reusable. Then we see a transfer and a descent stage, similar to the national team's lunar lander design. The Chinese are confident on building all these three items, but they are unsure yet if they also want to build their own version of the Lunar Gateway, as shown here, and if they also want to build their own pressurized lunar rover. So a Lunar Gateway station and a rover might only happen in later missions, as they aren't necessary for the landing itself. As for the detailed landing plan itself, some amazing people on NASA Space Flights Forum, link in the video description, have already translated the detailed 12-step plan. Thanks a lot for translating, Miss Aaron. You saved me a lot of work. So two of the new Chinese Falcon Heavy-like rockets will launch. One carrying the lander, the other one the Red Dragon capsule and service module. They will perform a TLI, then rendezvous in lunar vicinity. Afterwards, they will descend into a lunar orbit, and the lander decouples and lands. After successful landing and manned lunar exploration, the lander ascends and docks back with the service module and the Red Dragon, which have remained in orbit. But it's not clear if the lunar lander will remain in lunar orbit for later reuse. This will probably also depend on if China will also want to build their own lunar gateway later on. In any case, it's fascinating to see how detailed the Chinese moon plans already are, and that they are really pursuing this. They already have performed successful docking in low Earth orbit, had their own small space station, and are going to build their next space station in the coming years. So China is really to be taken seriously. And if NASA doesn't get the necessary funding for Artemis, it could be a close call which nation will land on the moon next.
Of course, we know that the SpaceX Starship is the big unknown here. If NASA doesn't get the necessary funding, it is quite likely, in our opinion, that Elon will say, you know what? What the hell? This is taking too long. Let's do our own private moon landing mission with Starship. But then this would not be a NASA mission, it would be a private moon landing mission. So there is indeed the possibility that China could beat NASA to the moon. That is, of course, for this new moon race, since NASA was already on the moon back in their glory days 50 years ago. But we think that China can definitely not beat SpaceX to the moon, because we really think that should Artemis not get the necessary funding and be delayed to 2028, SpaceX will conduct their own private moon landing mission. So beating NASA to the moon, maybe. But beating SpaceX to the moon, most certainly not. Because SpaceX doesn't depend on some stupid funding debates by politicians that have either no interest in spaceflight whatsoever or absolutely no clue about spaceflight. This is why SpaceX remains our best hope for the future of humanity in space, and not NASA or China. And while SpaceX is humanity's best hope for a future in space, NordPass is your best hope for safely storing and organizing all your passwords.
Today's video is sponsored by NordPass. So NordPass is the easiest and most convenient way to store all the passwords and to secure all your different accounts, credit card details, private notes, and much more, in a very uncomplicated and straightforward way.
And we know exactly what you think.
Are you insane? How can you give your passwords to someone else?
We used to write down every single password, but NordPass convinced us otherwise. It uses a zero-knowledge architecture, which means that your data is encrypted on your device before it even reaches the NordPass servers where it is backed up and synced. NordPass, and this is very important for us, thus certainly does not know your passwords. On top, NordPass is powered by NordVPN cybersecurity professionals with a lot of experience in the market.
Shopping online is probably the best example. NordPass will automatically generate extremely complicated passwords with lots of different character combinations. Once the password is saved, you can simply click on the NordPass icon to autofill the password and thus easily log into your account with just a few clicks. Of course, NordPass will also remember your credit card details, thus saving you even more time. So keep your passwords safe and organized and download NordPass for free. Yes, for free. Today at NordPass.com. So thanks for watching today's sponsored message.
And if you would like to know how the outcome of the upcoming US elections could influence the Artemis moon landing program, you can watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future. I would also be very, very happy.
Yes. Really?
No. Because for me, it wasn't clear. I'm so sorry.
Na gut. Hast ja recht.